everyone. I'm Carol Olson Day of the New York Times, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this exciting Times Talks. We're live here at the Times Center in New York, and we're live around the world on the web at timestalks.com. We are thrilled to have as our guests two of today's most compelling collaborators in film. One is an award-winning director, producer, writer, with great wit and style, and a distinguished body of work that has won him worldwide acclaim and a reputation as the very best in his craft. Our other guest is a celebrated actor and director who is undeniably one of the most accomplished talents of stage and screen today. Together, they and an all-star ensemble cast have collaborated on one of the most highly anticipated films of the year, The Grand Budapest Hotel. The movie, which recounts the exciting adventures of a legendary concierge at a famous European hotel between the wars, and the lobby boy who becomes his most trusted friend, premiered at the Berlin Film Festival, where it won the Grand Jury Prize, and it opens here March 7th. You'll hear much more about the film and our guests from our moderator. Every Monday, his New York Times Media Equation column is must reading for anyone concerned with how media intersects with culture, business, and society. He also writes extensively about film, television, and books for the arts pages of the Times. And he's the author of a frank and fascinating memoir, The Night of the Gun. But before we meet our guests and the moderator, let's take a look at the film.
Why do you want to be a lobby boy?
Who wouldn't? At the Grand Budapest, sir.
And so my life began. Junior lobby boy in training under the strict command of Monsieur Gustav H. Many of the hotel's most valued and distinguished guests came for him.
I love you.
I love you. She was dynamite in the sack, by the way.
She was 84.
I've had older.
This was also when I met Agatha.
She's charming. She's so charming.
Is he flirting with you?
Yes.
I approve of this union.
I became his pupil, and he was to be my counselor and guardian.
The police are here.
Tell them I'll be right down. She's been murdered, and you think I did it.
Hey! Stop!
You're looking so well, darling. You really are. I don't know what sort of cream they've put on you down at the morgue, but I want some.
This is Madame D's last will and testament. Monsieur Gustav H., I bequeath a painting known as Boy with Apple.
Wow.
What?
Who's Gustav H.?
I'm afraid that's me, darling.
If I learn you ever once laid a finger on my mother's body, living or dead...
I go to bed with all my friends.
We need to make a plan for your survival. Hide this. It's in code and you might need a magnifying glass to read it, but it tells you exactly where and how to find Boy with Apple.
I'm a baker. I'm not a fence, if that's the term.
May I offer any of you inmates a plate of mush?
I want roadblocks at every junction for 50 kilometers. I want rail blocks at every train station for 100 kilometers.
Get in!
I want 50 men and 10 bloodhounds ready in 5 minutes.
Can't arrest him simply because he's a bloody immigrant.
Take your hands off my lobby boy!
Have you ever been questioned by the authorities?
Yes, on one occasion.
What?
I was arrested and tortured by the rebel militia after the desert uprising.
Right. Well, you know the drill then. Zip it.
And now, please join me in welcoming New York Times Media Equation columnist David Carr and our very special guests, Wes Anderson and Ralph Fiennes.
Good evening. Nice to see you all. Thanks for coming, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Not that long ago, I was on, I was being filmed live for some interview, and they said, well, what is your favorite movie? And without hesitation, I said Rushmore. Hmm. Right? Yeah. Part of the reason I said that is because I never really looked at movies the same way afterwards, which is, I always thought movies were supposed to be sort of like life or close to life, but a movie can be really a movie, yes?
Yeah, you know, I think, well, you know, in one way, I can look at movies I love and kind of divide them into, you know, a Fellini school of movies and a Rossellini school. But I will say my experience,
meaning real and not real.
Yeah.
Or, okay.
Meaning work of imagination that can go as far as it wants into sort of fantasy and something that's trying to capture life as we live it and communicate something about that. But the thing I think, I mean, I'm making this up as I go along right now, so this way, whether this is going to add up or not, but
it sounds beautiful, so just keep it rolling.
I think as I kind of feel, I often have gone for myself in a conversation, somebody asking me a question about one of my movies, I kind of have used the Fellini line, you know, I'd say, well, I'm trying to do something in the Fellini school, but I will say, when I make these movies, I don't think of that line, you know. I think, you know, when we're doing this movie, Rafe is playing a real person and making him a real person, and even though the context is sort of is this sort of invented country and this invented version of history and so on, I don't know if I see what I don't know if I sort of feel like we just try to make it as realistic as it can be, given what it is, if that makes any sense.
Well, yeah, it does. I mean, real stuff happens. It's a caper movie. I mean, paintings disappear, fortunes are won and lost, families fight, thugs wander. There's even a chase scene, for crying out loud.
Yes, yeah, we got a ski chase. This actually, you know, it's been rare for me over the years to have a movie that has a plot, you know. Suddenly I feel like, wow. You know, there are things things to happen.
I noticed there was a beginning, middle, and end for this one. While I was laughing my head off, I was interested in the character you played, Rafe, in that I kept waiting for signals whether I was to love him in an unalloyed manner, as you would a movie hero, and he was a hero in a way, but he had certain tics that weren't all that lovable. And I'm wondering if you thought to yourself, well, we all contain multitudes. This guy's both good and vain and whatever. How did you think about Gustav?
Well, I get quite impatient when, in discussing a film or script that's about to be made, there's often a dialogue about, is the character sympathetic enough?
Right.
And that really irritates me. I think
did my question sort of veer toward
No. I mean, I'm confessing to a reaction I have, because I think the films I like to see and the performances or characters I like are when they're rounded and I'm challenged about where I'm meant to locate this person in terms of do I like or not like, but I like it when I'm full of questions,
right,
and that I see and I'm forced to have to think. So when you talk about, I love it, the idea that you don't know where to, a person might not know where to, how to judge Gustav. And in the end, he is, as you say, he's very clearly a hero, I believe. But I think I love all these tics. He's vain, he's fastidious, he's slightly controlling, he's arguably quite manipulative.
Very true blue, very loyal, very stand up in the end.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
One of his features or eccentricities is he's like the most perfumed man.
Yes.
Ever.
Yes.
And I had that really stuck on me when I was watching. I was like, well, so is it a flowery thing or is it a? So I'm wondering if you and Rafe talked that out, or perhaps you just dipped him in a bunch of cologne before you put him out there.
Well, I mean, you know what it is. What is it?
Well, I'm going to give a company a huge product placement if I can.
Please
do.
Okay.
Here comes one. Now, there's an Italian company based out of Florence called Santa Maria di Novella, and they'd have great colognes.
Yep.
So I bought a whole load of these colognes to try out. And I wore, there was one in the end that I went for that I liked. But I remember spraying you on the first day.
Yeah, which was almost a ritual.
Yeah.
An anointment.
Yeah. Could we take a stab at what it smelled like? What kind of spicy or fruity or?
Oh, God. Well, it was called.
Do you think there are traces of it on you right now if I came over and just sniffed deeply on you?
Yeah, lots of crevasses where it lingers.
One of the things that I thought was interesting about the movie, I'm the kind of person that I just love to buckle in and have a movie just take off, and this movie certainly meets that standard. But the country is invented. But it seems sort of recognizable. There are signals, but then there's very real forces in play. Here come the fascists, for instance, who are like Nazis, only sillier, right? Or what?
Yeah, they, yeah. Well, I think, it's an odd thing because the sort of impulse to start writing this thing in the first place. Part of it was to do a movie, you know, in some vague way about Europe and about real history and a real region, a real time. But then, for whatever reason, the avenue that I ended up choosing to go down to do that is with a country called Zubrovka that we've made up. And I think, you know, somebody knows this vodka.
That's what happened when I Google it, is that, like, you named your country after a vodka, for crying out loud.
It's a very good, yeah. We ended up kind of combining the First and Second World Wars, and, our story takes place in 1932 at a moment when it's sort of in between things, but it's sort of happening right then. I don't know if our fascists are even. I mean, I guess my point is, what we're exactly what we're referring to along the way in our story, even though it's a made-up thing. So it's an odd kind of mixture, but it's also it was the whole point, I guess.
One of the things that I used to wait tables. I worked fine dining for 7 years, and I'm probably in terms of manners and upbringing, not a likely candidate for that that role. I'm a little rugged, but it taught me some things. It shaved some of the corners off of me. And maybe it's just me, but there was like an underlying message of the importance of standards, mm-hmm. no matter what, that manners obtain, no matter where you are or what goes, because that was kind of a through line all the way through for he never lost, whether he was in prison or whether he's being chased, or he always was a well-mannered person.
Yeah, that's, you want to talk about that? I mean, he has a code, and I feel like
I think despite all this sort of surface peccadilloes and things, he's a profoundly honorable man, and I think he feels there's a real dignity in serving people and providing them with exquisite service and running this hotel to perfection. And for me, it's got an almost sort of, I mean, I think in some sort of a Japanese aesthetic about the placement
exactly
of the knife and fork on the table is perfect. How the food is presented is perfect. How the bed is made in the room or whatever. And you see this in good hotels, that it's sort of transmitted through all the staff. And it's amazing when you go into a hotel room and someone's laid out all your bathroom accessories and a little mat. I mean, it's sort of crazy, but it's... but this is... This is Gustav's world. This is what he's devoted his life to. And there's a great speech you give him, which he speaks to Zira about, you anticipating people's needs before the needs are needed. And it's a wonderful little sort of monologue about the sort of the principles of service. And that, for me, tied hand in hand. And also he delivers when the chips are down, and it means being there for someone in extremis. The ultimate service is giving yourself for someone else.
Yes.
He does it.
Right.
So is a sort of purity to him. And it's made all the more great, I think, because you give him all the sort of perfumes and the vanities and everything. But that's what, yeah.
Yeah, something like the good manners taken to an extreme are like a good ethics or something like that.
Very mannered manners.
Very mannered manners, yeah.
But he keeps them, like, even in jail, it's like, gentlemen, would you like some mush then? And he treats, like, one of the inmates looks like he's caught an axe right in the middle of his face. And he says, you with the giant scar, would you like some mush? And that guy ends up, there's a reciprocity.
Yes.
Later on, there is a validation that occurs when you treat one not only as you'd like to be treated, but maybe even better than that.
Right.
I was at a wedding this weekend in Philadelphia that was, forgive me, a very Jewish wedding, which meant that there was some food before the food, there was some food right before the food came, and then there was a five course, and then there was a dessert bar, and then there was food to take with you and food. And along the way, somebody next to me said, I'm not really hungry, I gotta say, about probably the third course of dinner. And I said, what is being signaled here is not that you need to be fed, but that one of abundance and comfort. And so, and this was just, it was a Sheraton in Philly, but they had a chilled salad fork, a chilled spoon for the palate cleanser. And I went from sort of laughing about it to thinking, you know, whoever runs this place, I'd like to meet him or her. You know what I mean? That they communicate through that there's something noble in service.
Yeah, and it's a sort of artwork that's being made, for, you know, an experience that you're being given that, you know, has its meaning.
This hotel that you made or found or built or, well, let's set that. The hotel is very much a character. It ages. It's lit different, it's shot different, we'll get into aspect ratios later. But how did you find it, and then how did you make it?
Yes, yeah, good, I like that. That's a good way to ask that. Once we had a script for the movie, I've made a script and I sort of know where we're gonna do it or what the general game plan is, and then on some of these things, I have just no idea. This one I had no idea. And I was doing quite a bit of research, and I kind of stumbled across this website for the, it's a photochrome collection in the United States Library of Congress. Am I saying that right? Library of Congress? Yes.
Yes.
And it's a section of their big giant website that's just called the photochrome collection. It's these black and white photographs that have been colorized. They're from the turn of the century, like 1895 to 1910, something like that. They were produced by some company in Kansas City or St. Louis or something, and another company in Switzerland. And there are thousands and thousands of these images that are cityscapes and landscapes, and it's like Google Earth of, you know, 1900. And they're fascinating. They go all through the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And I ended up on this website for, you know, weeks and weeks, and got a sense of what I thought the movie, the world that it was, very specific visuals that the world of this movie is meant to kind of evoke. And then we started going to these places and seeing how they don't exist anymore, and kind of went through a process like that. And we traveled quite a bit, to figure that out. But
who's the we?
The we is me and our producer Jeremy Dawson,
okay.
and then a friend. You know, at different times, different people. My friend George traveled with me. My girlfriend traveled with us sometimes. And anyway, I mean, this is a little long-winded, but we sort of gathered.
So Times Talk, be as long-winded as you like. Okay. They're here to listen to you.
So I'm going to keep going. We got lots of ideas. We found lots of hotels where we decided not to shoot, but where we found ingredients. And finally, we ended up in this place called Görlitz, where Rafe had actually made, you know, Rafe had worked, the part of the reader was shot in this German city of Görlitz. And we found this department store that was empty. And it was Jugendstil, that's like art, some kind of German Art Nouveau kind of architecture, an amazing, have you ever been to the Bon Marché in Paris?
Sure.
Well, it's like the Bon Marché. It's a great big atrium with these vaulted staircases and everything. And we thought, well, this would be a great lobby for the hotel. And we sort of started to use things from every place that we had found. We sort of did greatest hits of, you know, old hotels and put them all together in this town of Görlitz. And the other thing is, as we were traveling, we saw the way that the communist period in that part of the world is reflected in the architecture, in these, you know, these beautiful old buildings, and then there's a layer of, you know, 1950s utilitarian, architecture. And you sort of see the layers of history in it, and that kind of changed how we represented the aging of our hotel. It went from a place that, in the script, it's a place that just became more dilapidated. Well, in the movie, it's a place that sort of changes regimes, or, you know, there's an ideology that's changed in this gap.
It goes from kind of the Belle Epoque to fascism.
To communism.
And it sort of gets flattened a bit and sort of cleaned up, and a lot of the ornamentation.
The audience experiences the hotel in its sort of communistic style, doesn't it, first?
Yes.
And then they go back.
And then they see the way it was when it was, the Belle Epoque version of the place.
But you actually shot, I don't even really know what an aspect ratio is, per se.
Yep.
But I read the clips close enough to know that you changed aspect ratios, which is the shape, or?
Yes. It's
the shape.
Yeah.
So.
It's
and
shape.
When I read that afterwards, and I thought, well, was I supposed to notice, or is it good that I didn't?
I think it's good you didn't. You know, it's one of those things where, I mean, I think it doesn't matter, but I think it's fine if you notice. What I sort of felt that what we did is, I've always wanted to do a movie in the what they call the Academy aspect ratio that turns out to be one, you know, it's basically a square. It's, you know, every movie before 1952 or whenever it is, whenever CinemaScope and VistaVision happened, everything before that is all basically a square, almost a square. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've always wanted to do a movie that way. It used to be very difficult. I mean, it used to be sort of impossible because they would have to change the gate on every projector, and I think there are things with the lenses. When it's real projection, it's complicated to get multiplexes to show a movie that way.
Right.
Now it's digital, and it just is what it, and you just somebody just flips a switch, and it's just going to do what it's going to do, no matter. You just tell it what to do in advance. So with this one, I thought we could do. We ended up kind of evolving to this thing that most of the movie would be in the old-fashioned aspect ratio, the Academy, and we'd lead into it with some different things. The '60s part of the movie we did with these lenses called technoscope that are very possibly we're using the same lenses as a fistful of dollars or something like that. You know, they're like old Italian widescreen lenses. So anyway, the movie goes like this, and then it goes like that. And I think you don't notice. I mean, we're so used to these changing shapes from the stuff we look at on the internet and everything else. And I just don't think it's something you can feel something change. You know, and I think the thing I was kind of hoping is what you'd feel is that the movie would grow, vertically, and that would give you some kind of feeling.
Yeah, I would say that given the fact that I always show up in the third row with a bucket of popcorn and expect everything to be great, that's silly, except it's sort of where movie magic comes from, or these choices that we... I can remember I was talking to a young man who made Beasts of the Southern Wild, and he said, well, it's very important to me that the orcs, the big monsters in that movie, were on a human-powered treadmill. And I just thought, all you guys with your freaky detail, I would never notice that. And yet I love the movie.
Yeah.
So many times it's a lot of preparation that isn't necessarily seen, but is felt or experienced.
Yeah, I think that's the case. Often something that makes, because movies are such a kind of, they can be very simple, but it's a sort of complicated medium because it's images that are captured in a kind of complicated way, and sounds and music and writing and performance, and it's all these different things, and sometimes that you mix these chemicals together. Well, I feel my experience in making movies. I mean, you've directed two movies. I wonder how if it's two wonderful movies.
Yeah, The Invisible Woman.
My experience making these, you decide all these things, and then the thing happens on the set, and then you put it together, and it's a surprise when you see what this mixture, what it's like when you combine these things. Was that your experience as a director?
Yeah, well, the biggest learning curve, the newest thing that I had was editing. I mean, I had directing the first time on a film set I'd been on film sets, so it was an adjustment, but I knew the environment and I...
You just had to switch sides of the camera.
Yeah, but it was confronting everything in the editing suite with a great editor, in fact, but it was just, I found that the real shock, and I'd never been in that process, what it meant to choose takes. And this thing that you've heard, maybe it's a bit of a cliche about performances are made in the editing room, but I understand what that means now, because you're sifting through all kinds of material, and then if it's the first time you've been in an editing process, where the editor chooses to make the cut and how that affects everything that's gone before, I mean, it's just obviously stuff you know so well, but it was a wonderful, scary, and as a happy shock.
Yeah,
to confront this whole other thing, which I had never really been close to before.
Right.
But yeah. In the two movies that you've directed, now you own a Tony, you nominated for an Academy Award for Schindler's List, but in these movies, the first one, I'm terrified to say it, I'm going to try it, Coriolanus.
Bravo.
Exactly right.
And it's not hard to pronounce The Invisible Woman, which is a really amazing film. Did that leave you, given the fact that now you've made two of your own films, were you, you and Wes had wanted to work together for a while, and that was well stated, but were you looking over his shoulder a little bit in terms of either trying to grab something out of his bag of tricks or...
Well, the first thing that I was I loved about on my first meeting with Wes, when we sat down, we read the script together, and one of the first things that you showed me alongside, we talked about the script, we read it through, and I remember we just dived in. I read it and you gave me feedback on. One of the things I think we had to find was the pitch of Gustav, what the nuance, the right tone was for him. But alongside that meeting, you had these storyboards, which, and some of them were even animated in a simple way. And so I had tried to be prepared, but nothing. This was another level of being prepared, where, in fact, these animated storyboards were even edited. I mean, I thought it was fantastic to see that sort of precision. And I loved being, you know, at close quarters to the precise way that Wes gathers everything together, whether it's, it's the camera position, sets, the props, but also I think it's, you bring everything together in this very highly defined way, and then all these actors, this is a movie full of fantastic actors, and it seems to me that you then want them to bring all their own individual imagination, talents, whatever. You want each actor to be, you know, given their arena for who they are, and there was a wonderful. It was interesting the different energies on your set, because you exude a sort of huge enthusiasm for whichever actor it is, and Wes does a lot of takes. We're shooting on film, and Wes does not like to cut. So, and there must be masses of stuff on the editing floor of you giving notes to the actors recorded on celluloid.
Wow. We're going to want to see the DVD extra on this baby.
But I guess it's a kind of luxury, but also there is this thing when you, I think, tell me if I'm wrong, but when you say cut sometimes on a set, with the actor and the director, there's a kind of link, and they know it's something is being held while someone changes a magazine. But often there's a sort of, and people relax and noise happens. And it's often very hard then, the magazines, if you're on film, this is, the magazine's reloaded, and then you have to, but I think what I got the sense is you didn't want to let that, the ball drop.
I hate to cut because you risk breaking the spell.
Yeah, yeah.
And so what we do is often. I mean, maybe you, I wonder if you were seeing this happen sometimes. We say I say still rolling, still rolling. They've cut. I think everybody knows that we've cut. They're doing things and Fredo doing things. I say still rolling, very quickly. At least it gives me the sense
the illusion,
that
we,
that the tension is still there.
Okay.
Well,
I bought it. I get it.
Yeah. oftentimes, as you know, we don't cut, and we do. I think you and I both like to do a lot of takes.
Yeah.
And we do them very, very quickly. You know, one after another, we could do a whole bunch of them. I feel like the movie like this one, it's where we've made this animatic thing. It's very prepared and everything's there. But when everybody gets together, it's I like that. To me, it feels a little bit like chaos.
But I think that's what should be the beauty of being well prepared, is that you have it all, and then you can let it go.
Yes. Yeah. And you get a group of actors this group together, and it's I really feel like I just step back and all sorts of things start happening.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I would. To me, I asked. I don't know anything about acting, but I asked a friend of mine. I said, you know, Wes's films require a lot of specificity from actors. It's not like, you know, walk in there, let's see what you got, throw it down. There's a bandwidth of discourse. Your guy's gonna talk fast. He's gonna speak in a certain way. And I understand that it's important that you're animating them, but so many specifics are required. I said, why does Jason Schwartzman, Owen Wilson, Jude Law, Rafe, Tilda, William Dafoe, they all come racing from around the globe to work with you. And and to do these really specific things. And my actor friend said, well, you've answered your own question. It's a joy to know what is expected and try and hit it hard, try and do a good job.
We developed a kind of rhythm, didn't we? I remember saying to you, can I please do my first, don't say anything, let me just have a go, first couple of takes, and then please give me everything you want. Ask, you know, give me my notes. And then when you're happy, then let me free again.
Yeah.
And sometimes you let me free, I did something, and then you would start a roll all over again and go, okay, that's good, let's do that. And we go through sort of different zones of experience in the 20 or 30 takes.
Yeah.
You
did.
Now, you said you love lots of takes, but you said he does too.
He does. Well, because, you know, Rafe is somebody who, it's, you know, my experience on the set is, so, you know, sometimes I am saying a bunch of things probably that you know, I feel like everybody just does what they want to do, but probably that's not your experience, or maybe you don't see it that way. I think
all you've done is pick their outfits, decided where they stand, what they're going to say, and how they're going to move. Other than that, everything else is up.
But I don't feel I tell them how they're going to move or anything.
Okay,
like
you're
that.
Right.
It's that's improvised. But the thing I think that happens is I start to work. We do it. We do eight takes. We do 12 takes. I start to feel like now everybody wants us to move on, you know. And I can feel not just the people playing the scene who say, now I've done it five times in a row exactly the same way, and where are we going with it? Or you know, there's a whole crew of people who have to move the camera 30 times, you know, and they And people just checking their watch and saying, what's going to happen here? We make our days, you know, and it's a luxury to me to have somebody there with me who is a formidable personality on the set who says one more yes one more, he wants to do it again. I enjoy that. The other thing is, you know, part of the thing part of what made me want to work with Rafe in the abstract, before this character, and I like actors who, you know, as much as I may seem like I've got, I have a plan I want to do or something, I like actors who, you know, have their own thing, and they all, I mean, he owns the character, and I react, I respond, and all that kind of thing. And you know, you want collaborators like that who bring a force to it, I guess.
One of the things I wondered about when I saw all the talent that you jammed into this movie is, did you have any actor friends, like members of your regular gang, that just felt terrible that they didn't get to be in on this caper?
Nobody said anything.
No.
Can't think of anybody. You know, I did try to, you know, I mean, I, yeah.
You know what I mean? It's your whole gang plus all these other, because Rafe's making his first movie with you, and you got Sarcy, and you've got this newcomer kid. I want to talk about him. And it's like, well, why didn't my phone ring? Everybody's in here. Bill Murray played a concierge for crying out loud.
Well, sometimes I feel a little funny if I'm asking somebody who's a well-known actor who I love, and I say, here's what I've got for you. Will you do this little thing? And you know, maybe that's the thing that makes me uneasy sometimes. But I feel like this kind of movie. I think it's the kind of movie where you can put recognizable people, known people, in smaller parts, and it's kind of good for it. It's not like, it doesn't feel like cameos. It feels like characters. You know, great actors for little, you know, a character that has a shorter part. Something about the tone of it, I like to think, is suited to that. But yeah, we got a good gang for this one, for sure.
Do you have, and I think I agree with you that partly because people are done in character, done in makeup, heavy. So just about the time as a viewer you're clocking, hey, wait a minute, isn't that, then they're gone, and then you're on to next. So it's almost at these ghostly cameos where you know these people, you trust these people, but you don't really totally recognize them until they're almost gone. But now, you've made the movie, so why do actors, some of whom have quite a few options, including yourself, go over hill and dale to work with this guy?
Well, I guess there are actors who've worked with Wes many times, and I guess they would have the answer would be different, because this is my first time being invited. I mean, I've loved Wes's films, but you don't. I mean, there are sort of stages in which one is drawn into committing to. I mean, there's a script which is sent, and there's a part which you read, and it's a good part or it's not, or clearly this is a fantastic role. So there were all these things about Wes that I've seen his films, we'd met socially a little bit. But actually, I think the thing that was, it was our meeting, reading, we met and we tried out some hair pieces and moustaches and suddenly the theory of, oh, it would be great to work with Wes and here's a great role, suddenly that sort of drifted away, and here was this man sharing the spirit of his imagination with me and all kinds of other things that come in. You eat really well when you work with Wes. You go to lovely restaurants. The conversation is great, not just about the movie. We talk about other things. You meet other great people, not just the other actors, but other great people that are companions of Wes. And so there's a whole other thing that happens, which I don't think I can't really compare it to any other experience. And then the being on location, where everyone is in the same hotel, we dress, we put our costumes in our bedrooms. There's no makeup trailers, and the makeup department is in the hotel. So you get up, you go down, have breakfast, go straight to makeup, go back up to your room, put on your clothes, and everyone is bumping into each other in the hotel lobby or on the stairwell. And that engenders something, I wasn't sure how it would work out going in, what it would be like.
Well, I remember you said, this is a little hotel that we took over, it was just
on the border of
half of the city's in Germany and half is in Poland.
So you'd like lunch in Poland.
That's right.
Because it was cheap.
It was a different currency and the exchange rate is very favorable.
They're not
us.
On the euro.
Yeah. You know? Yes, and also it's a different kind of, there's a lot more, there's a lot of rabbits and things that we're eating on the other side of the river. Yes, Polish rabbits. I remember I described to you sort of, here's what we've got in mind, and we're going to have, and we it's not a big budget movie. People make a lot more, when you're M, you get a lot more than when you're M Gustav.
Yeah.
well said.
But we have a good cook. So he's with us, and I remember I explained to you, I said, so each night we'll have this thing, and you said, okay, well, that's great, but what if I want to have my own dinner, I mean, every night of the whole movie, I have to show up, and I was like, no, you don't have to, you do what you like. Well, you were there literally every single dinner for the entire movie. I think you liked it. So I was very pleased to see that.
So you're taking attendance at dinner a little bit. That I'm interested in, I had an opportunity to watch the movie a second time so I could think about certain things. And I want to just see the movie to start, right, and not take a bunch of notes. But one of the things I was thinking about with your character is mentoring young Zero, right? Mm-hmm. But then I thought, well, in the world of making this movie, you probably did have to mentor that guy. I mean, Tony Revolori, right? Yeah. And how old is he?
He's 17.
He was 16, never been in a feature.
He was 16 a year ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he's doing scenes with Rafe. And I mean, you probably had to take him under your wing a little bit, yes?
Yeah, yes. He's a fantastic guy, Tony. He'd done some work with Wes before I met him. He knew all his lines inside out. We'd often just riff our lines. We'd practice our lines nonstop. He was wonderful to watch him. He has a wonderful gentle confidence about him, which is not a sort of a confidence that makes you warm to him, because he's very open to listening and if you give him advice or a suggestion. But it was actually very touching to see him evolve. And he'd be obviously watching all these other actors, but he developed, I thought, a wonderful natural, his instinct for the comedic tone that you were after, I thought, just grew very, very quickly. Mm. And then I thought within the space of a week or two, he was already good when we started, but there was something that you could feel him just owning Zero very quickly. And he was wonderful to work with. Here's a young guy with limited experience, but actually that didn't ever occur to me. He just seemed like a natural partner.
Yeah, well, I remember getting into the editing room and realize there's a degree to which, you know, throughout this movie, he's in the shots all the time, and you're talking and talking and talking and talking and talking. And it sort of didn't occur to me until I was in the cutting room that, on the set, I just watched you. Mm-hmm. I barely looked at Tony, mm-hmm. I mean, unless he was doing something, unless we had something in particular to do. And he's always in the scene, mm-hmm. and he's always reacting and listening. Yeah. He made a performance that, you know, I wasn't even necessarily witnessing at the time. Was. But I could feel that he was connected to you, yeah. I mean, you liked him when you first saw him. You said to me when you first saw him, you know, I showed you a video of him, and I think he felt very embraced by you, and it made him confident, you know.
I mean, part of what the subtext is, so he's being mentored by Gustav, but Gustav is like this omnivorous, omnisexual, tends to grab onto everything around him. So he can be a good friend, but you need good fences. And Tony has to sort of back your character up a few times, and because your character would apparently sleep with just about anything that moves, including his fiance. So he did have to kind of like be mentored by you, but also keep you sort of backed up at a certain point and have some boundaries.
Yep.
I was worried that might be the answer to that. Okay, a lot of times when I read the production notes for a movie, they come to the author that inspired it or the character, and then I come and I read, Stefan Zweig, of course. Who is that?
Stefan Zweig.
Okay, this is, what he said.
Yes.
Stefan Zweig.
This is a... Now, I don't know how many... Maybe... Do people know Zweig? Like, do a lot of people... Yeah, she does. I had never heard of him until about...
Good, because I'm like, six years ago.
Yeah. Well, in Europe, they can't believe that we don't know Zweig. I want to say 6 or 7 years ago, New York Review of Books Press and Pushkin Press in England, they started bringing these books back into print. There were new translations, and they started bringing them back into print in English, and they'd been out of print. He was a humongous star in his time. He was a major best-selling
writer.
Are
we in like turn of the century Vienna, or when are we?
No, we're in the 30s and 40s.
Okay.
We're in the 30s, the 20s and the 30s, let's say. I mean, especially the 30s. But maybe from the mid-20s to 1942. He, you know, he committed suicide in 1942. He's a wonderful writer. The stories are very psychological, whatever that implies. There's a feeling that you're getting psychology out of these stories. And he was friends with Freud, and an admirer and friends of Freud. But they're told his style is sort of like someone who tells tales. You know, it could almost be like a Kipling or a Conrad. There's something about the stories that the subject matter, it's the relationship between the subject matter and the way the stories are told is unusual and very effective. I mean, they were just hugely popular books. And also there's a memoir, The World of Yesterday, which he wrote at the end of his life, that is really about the world that was destroyed in 1914, the world that began to be destroyed in 1914, and in a way for him, his motivation to go on living begins to ebb. His fiction and this memoir are really the reason why I kind of felt like I would like to do a European story.
We talked about the literary influences, but like you're a movie nut and you love films, and I'm wondering sort of, because there's, and I mean this as a compliment, but there was almost something sort of, like this to me was kind of a silent movie that talked.
Mm-hmm.
And it reminded me of, and I, this could have to do with aspect ratios or whatever it is, but I'm wondering who you were, not necessarily directly quoting, but who you were thinking about when you made this movie.
Well, you know, we had an interesting thing because we were all living together. We made a little library of DVDs. Of movies that somehow I had stolen something from or thought were somehow connected to the movie, and it was very nice because, you know, we had books on the table, we had DVDs, people would come and take them, and Edward Norton is watching, you know, the To Be or Not to Be, and Willem Dafoe has the Silence, the Bergman movie, you know, we kind of shared these movies. I think especially Hollywood movies by emigre directors.
Lubitsch.
Yes, Lubitsch, Billy Wilder, Fritz Lang. They're, for some reason, these guys who went to Hollywood and often made movies in Culver City or Burbank that are set in Budapest or Warsaw. Those were a particular inspiration, I think.
I wonder when you settle on this part of what I think is, well, this feels like I'm in a book. Feels like I'm in a book. But do you think to yourself, is there, before you even get there, do you have this whole thing contained in your head, like how it's gonna go?
Well, you know, the movie is it's sort of supposed to be a book. And we have a character that's I don't want to bore everyone with describing how this is, but you know, we begin the movie with a sort of memorial to an author, and then we meet the author, and we go back a few years to when he was alive, and he has a few things to say to us, and then we go back a few more years, and the author, I mean, this starts to get a little complicated, but I think sort of a fictionalized version of the author now appears as a younger man, and a
lot of meta going on here.
There's a lot of layers.
Yes.
Yeah. And he meets F. Murray Abraham. That's Jude Law meets F. Murray Abraham, and that eventually leads us to going back another step in time when Murray Abraham's character is young, and there's at least three or four different narrators, but people doing voiceover. There's four different people who do voiceover in the movie. It is meant to be sort of a literary feeling. Even the way some of the characters talk, Murray Abraham and Jude Law, I think I was trying to write it like it sounds like a book.
Right.
I mean, hopefully that ends up being a kind of interesting experience. But it's probably more, in some way, it's more book than movie.
I feel bad because we've stuck to this movie which you guys haven't seen. And that's probably poor form as a moderator. So I just want to step back just a little bit. But your career as a director, you've done a great job of making movies. It isn't like you've been on any kind of career track as a director. The only thing you ever set out to make, it seems to me, is a Wes Anderson film.
Yeah, well, I mean, each time I start one of these things, I feel like I'm doing a completely different thing, and we go to a different country, we have a different set of, a whole different kind of story to me. I feel like everything I'm doing is different from what I've done before, and then every time even if somebody likes it, it's more the same, but I like it. That's the best case scenario.
I'm not going with those guys, because I mean, from Moonrise Kingdom to this movie, very different. One is a super miniature; it's contained on an island. It's domestic strife of a whole other order and a different kind, marital, etc. And this is on a broad canvas with world events. I'm not suggesting that. I'm just saying, as an actor or as a director, it's like one for them, one for me, one for them, one for me. You never do the one for them.
Right, you're right, yeah. Yeah. Well, part of that is this. It's not like I'm fending off all these offers to get to, they go to Sam Mendes. They didn't go to me.
So when they got Rafe to do the Bond movie, they didn't call up and say, hey, how'd you like to?
No, I never got that call.
I'd like to see your Bond movie.
I have one. Do you want to hear? You don't want to hear my Bond?
I'd like you to.
I've had this Bond movie for you. I mean, this is probably part of the thing. I had this one I wanted to do, called Mission Deferred. And my idea is that this is James Bond. This was a few years ago. The Cold War is over, and there's no gig. I had this idea. He's in. He goes in to see M, and M is on the phone, and he's walking around M's office. And finally says, and I kind of thought like the gadgetry is like he has a great coffee machine. And that maybe he gets into a bar fight or something because he has a license to kill, but there's whistle. I never got the call. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Thank you. That was great fun. Thank you.